Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I am Edwin Garcia, and welcome back. This is lecture three on the material science of rechargeable batteries as part of nanoHUB-U. This lecture is entitled Energy and Power in a Rechargeable Battery. Okay, last class, we were basically looking at the pros and cons of increasing the voltage, picking a material that has high voltage versus the amount of charge that we can store in that material. We found several interesting things. For example, the fact that that regardless of what cathode we pick, we will always have an imbalance on how much charge we can pick in the anode. We can store in the anode, and giving us with that the opportunity to engineer the thickness, the porosity, and the specific chemistry that we can use, and whether or not we can use that material to a high energy application or a high power density application. Okay. Today I want to talk about the different parts of lingo and quantities that we can now describe based on this small framework that we have created. The first one is called the voltage versus capacity plot. Some people refer to it as simply the capacity plot. And what you have here is basically the voltage of the cell for different current densities. You can see that current density in this case is 2.08 milliamps per centimeter square, which is referred to as 1C. I'll say what that is in 1 second, okay, which corresponds to this plot over here. And as we go from this side of the plot to that one, we have increasingly larger current densities. And this axis corresponds to how much charge the material has utilized. Okay, you can think of this as the current density that the material is being extracted for that specific discharge times the time, giving you effectively the amount of charge that you're utilizing. And in this case, this plot has been normalized to how much charge has been used by a battery that is actually 10 over 2, or no, so 2 over 10, a 2C rate, a 0.2C rate. In this case, as you can see, each of these curves is labeled as a function of fractions of C. C rate, if you may, is the number of hours. This factor that is ahead of the letter C corresponds to 1 over the number of hours that each battery will take to discharge. So a battery that discharges, like this one, at 1C is a battery that discharges in 1 hour. A battery that discharges in 2C discharges as 1 over 2 hours, which is half an hour. Okay. A battery that is 4C discharges in a quarter of an hour or 15 minutes. Well, this one over here will be 2 over 10, right? Which would basically 20 hours, right, to discharge. Okay. And all of them are in the same plot because we want to account for how much charge you are effectively extracting and related to the amount of potential associated with it. Okay? There's more associated with that, but typically when you're benchmarking one of these materials, one of these batteries, what you do is you tend to describe it like this to see when and at what current density you will hit your cutoff voltage, either that being 2 volts or 3 volts. If the cutoff voltage were 3 volts, you can see that after 5C, it doesn't matter what you do, you will be below the cutoff voltage. Okay? Now, how much energy in theory you can totally extract out of this, that's another quantity that people use. It's called the maximum theoretical specific energy, or MTSE. MTSE is defined effectively as basically X, basically the amount of charge we had already extracted from it, times Z times F, where E in this case is defined as the voltage of the system, and we divide it by the molecular weight of the system. You can think of it as the energy that theoretically the specific chemistry that we're using delivers or gives you the amount of energy. For the entire battery, however, the anode will have an MTSE and the cathode will have an MTSE. So what you really want okay, is to figure out which of both electrodes will deliver the smallest amount of charge, because that will tell you how much material you can actually store in one or the other one, and it's really the smallest one that is determining how much you can put in one or the other one. Okay, so the smallest of the cathode and the anode times the voltage difference between cathode and anode divided by the total mass of the battery. And by this, I not only mean the mass associated to the particles of material and the binder and the electrolyte and the carbon. I also mean the contacts. I also mean the casing and every single little bit that forms the battery. As you can see, this number, the MTSC of the battery, is very different, or if you prefer, the theoretical energy or specific energy of the battery can be very different as to what each of the chemistries can deliver. Okay, and the units, even though you would think of it as being joules per kilogram, are actually reported in watt times hours per kilogram. Why? Because again, just like we were discussing in previous lectures, in watt hours per kilogram, even though it has units of joules, we want to know when you have a device how much wattage you're using and for how long you're going to be able to use it, right? And, well, in a per kilogram basis, because you care about the weight as you're using it. It's not the same if I have the same amount of energy in what will look like a jug of milk as compared to I have the same amount of energy in what will look like a tequila shot. In both cases, I have the same energy, but the energy that I can store in a per kilogram basis can be very different. Okay? Now, here, that's the theoretical definition. Okay, how we're getting that energy out of the system. Is given by, in practice, by how the current is being extracted from the system. In this case, the current density times the voltage associated to that system. As you have learned before, that voltage actually varies with the state of charge, so it's indeed a function of time. So we have to integrate it between the time where we start to the time where we reach the cutoff voltage divided by the total mass of the system. Okay? Ideally, for a composite battery, we would have that number, okay, as we were discussing before, the MTSC of the battery, but really, we can relate it to the energetics of the system, and if we really want to associate to that the charge associated to the composite electrode, what we really want to do, we can build that quantity for the composite electrode, okay, and say then that ideal voltage from the battery corresponds to the voltage difference between cathode and anode, divided of course by the mass associated with the system, times the solubility limit, in this case of the species that had the lowest amount of charge we can store, modulated by the porosity associated with that electrode that had the lowest capacity times the thickness of the electrode. Okay. And as you can see already, all the lessons that we've been learning until now apply, because you can see if you want to increase the energy of your battery, you want to maximize the voltage difference between anode and cathode, you want to make it as light as possible, you want to be able to store as much charge as possible in the electrode that stores the least amount of material, and you want to basically remove as much fillers and porosity as you can in your system in order to increase it. And of course, you always have the additional knob of increasing the thickness of the electrode. However, if I decrease the porosity of my system, I will start having additional losses as a result of the transport in order to reach each of the individual particles. If I make it very thick, I will have voltage drops as a result of the long distance that the electrons have to and the ions have to travel in order to get there. And so we do want to think of these as starting points to select both cathode and anode. And that's really all we can say about it, because we would have to add additional contributions such as the different losses in order to have a much more appropriate description of the system. Okay, in order to extract the power density, is very similar to the definition we specified for energy density. If you remember in the previous slide, we have the current times the voltage times time. Why? Because again, current times time basically gives me charge, and charge times voltage gives me energy, divided by the mass gives me the energy density. And in this case, if I divide it by the time in which I use that energy, that gives me the average power that the system will deliver. This quantity has to be distinguished from the power that at an instance you can get, because as many of you may have learned from using, say, power tools or even toys, the power that you will feel that your car has, or say your electrical car or your actual electronics, at the beginning of playing with it is not going to be the same as at the end of the discharge process, right? Because this current is going to be varying and the voltage is going to be varying in time. Okay, so that quantity only gives you the average value. So we can relate that to the quantities we have defined, again, by using the amount of charge that each of the electrodes can give us times the ideal voltage, that is the voltage drop. Okay, and again, in the exact same way, okay, we will need to specify, to identify which of the two electrodes, most likely the cathode, will specify the limiting rate for storing amount of charge, and this ideal voltage will correspond to the amount, to the voltage difference between anode and cathode. And again, we want this number E sub A to be as small as possible in order to get the highest possible power associated with the system. And what we just said on the previous slide applies regarding porosity, solubility limits, and thickness, but now we want to make this number that, depending on what charge rate I use, on what C rate I'm using, I can get this number to be very high. Ideally, again, you want to have high power and high energy density in your battery, because that will both give you be able to use it for different types of applications. As you can see, the name of the game is specifying a high amount of power, at least average amount of power, a high amount of energy, given the charge and voltage that the system gives you, like in the plot I showed you before. Okay? Now, what actually ends up happening is that you can benchmark the performance of your battery by plotting it in terms of, in the x-axis, the energy, in energy density terms, watt-hours per kilogram, as a function with respect to the power density that the system will deliver. This is a semi-log plot, okay, and you can basically benchmark every single technology, battery technology that historically we have seen. Okay, here you have just several of them, and I mean it's almost interesting how the history developed. How we have the lead acid battery gave us a relatively poor energy density, and then all we did to go from this simple battery to the lead acid spirally wound batteries, all we did is, instead of putting it in layers, we just started wounding it, okay? And then at some point during the 80s, we started using the nickel cadmium system. I am sure you had at least seen in movies these the initial cell phones, that they look like these giant bricks, okay? Because the battery had a nickel cadmium cell, so you have a lot of volume occupying a certain amount of charge. Well, that's the reason, right? Then we went and had a jump in performance. You can see roughly the same power density by increasing the energy density by introducing nickel metal hydride. And you can see there's almost a factor of two improvement from one to the other one. In fact, you can kind of tell that from lead acid to nickel cadmium, there was a factor of two improvement. And from nickel cadmium to nickel metal hydride, there was another factor of two improvement. Okay, roughly we just kept working in that direction to improve the performance. Okay, these, of course, the nickel metal hydride is being used all over the place. I'm sure you've seen them in hybrid vehicles, in cell phones, in phones around the house, right? Here's another technology, the sodium nickel dichloride. This was basically invented during World War II. You can see it has a very it again roughly doubles the energy that a nickel metal hydride battery delivers. The advantage of this one is that, besides the energy density, it's very stable. The disadvantage is that you need around 300 to 400 degrees C to run it, okay, which means it's not the kind of battery you would have sitting on your lap, okay? But it, again, once the reaction starts, the reaction becomes self, it basically it continues itself. And people use this type of battery these days. A couple of companies, I think spin-offs from GE have emerged where they're using that, say, to power things like trains and things like that. Because if you think about it, you can use, for example, the slowing down of the train to recharge a battery, and the energy that is generated from that, you can store it in batteries within the train, and I find it a very neat application. Obviously, you will not go in a plane with one of these because of the high temperature, but you can see it can have its own niche application. Now, rechargeable batteries, lithium-ion batteries, completely changed the game. Again, we went from roughly 100 watt-hours per kilogram. Well, in this case, it was a factor of 1.6, and you can see the gain in performance just from that. And as compared to before, where we just have these individual regions, the lithium-ion technology basically split into different regimes. If you wanted a high energy density application, then what you wanted to do is to put a lot of energy, but you'll notice that you will be limited by how much charge you can get out of it. If you wanted to increase the power density, you would remove some of the material out to open more paths for lithium to transport. Basically, you would increase the porosity, increasing with that the power density. You would compromise energy in order to get more power, or you would take even more out and make it perform as well as a nickel cadmium or as well as a nickel metal hydride in, when it comes to energy density, but orders of magnitude higher when it comes to power density. Okay, this gives us some interesting performance in the response of the system, and you can see how you can basically tune the different types of response depending on where you are, or depending on what application you want to use, right? You can think of cell phones over here, hybrid vehicles and power tools, depending on when you are or where you want to be. Down here, this limit will be basically the material limit of the system, modulated by the porosity of the system. And over here, on this extreme, you will be limited by the transport limitations of the individual phases as you're shuttling electrons from one electrode to the other one. Okay, and engineering of the system from the material science point of view correspond to finding what parameters you tune to specify your application. Okay, in the next lecture, we will be elaborating further on this. Okay, but what I can tell you already is that if you wanted to improve the performance of the system, you obviously want this boundary to move further up, and unless we find an additional loophole in the system, we will be always be limited with this by this envelope, but alternative, we always want to be going up and to the right in this plot. Okay? Thank you.